That's his right son. You're just going to move him across.
What part? Can you give me an idea what part of the dog that is?
Up on his like thigh, of his leg.
That was poorly.
The picture of my finger is also 8 days after it was bit. That wasn't that day.
Oh, the poor dog.
Mr. Curtis, would you please state your full name for the record?
My name is Clinton Eugene Curtis.
And where do you reside?
Tallahassee, Florida.
And what is your profession?
I'm a computer programmer.
Would you please speak into the microphone so the audience can hear your testimony?
I'm a computer programmer.
Mr. Curtis, are there programs that can be used to secretly fix elections?
Yes.
How do you know that to be the case?
Because in October of 2000, I wrote a prototype for President Congressman Tom Feeney at the company I worked for in Oviedo, Florida, that did just that.
It would rig an election?
It would flip the vote 51-49 to whoever you wanted it to go to and whichever race you wanted to win.
And would that program that you designed be something that elections officials that might be on county boards of elections could detect?
They'd never see it.
Mr. Would you answer that question once again?
They would never see it.
So how would such a program, a secret program that fixes the election, how could it be detected?
You would have to view it either in the source code or you'd have to have a receipt and then count the hard paper against the actual vote total. Other than that, you won't see it.
All right, Mr. Curtis, if you had been asked, you or others with your professional expertise had been asked to design a protective program that would protect the Ohio elections from against such software to fix the election, could you have done so?
If we've been asked to make a program that could fix the election, sure, anybody can do it.
Are the electronic voting machines used across the country vulnerable to hacking? One professor decided to find out for himself.
That's right. Joining us right now, Princeton University professor Ed Felton with a demonstration from his study. Good morning to you, Ed.
Good morning.
Also, right over there across the studio, you got the two kids from Princeton who actually did this work, Ari and Alex. Now, tell us, 5% of the country votes with machines like this, right?
Yes, that's right.
And you are able to hack into it in 10 seconds.
It takes only a few seconds to insert a computer virus into this voting machine.
But how technologically savvy do you have to be a hacker to do this? I mean,
you have to be able to write computer programs.
Yep.
Which a lot of people can do.
Sure.
You need to be able to open up this door on the side, which anybody can do,
and
that's about it.
All right, let's see how it works.
Yeah, you want to show me if I'm voting, what happens, how it goes wrong, you say.
So we have set this machine up. We've infected it with our virus in advance, and we're running a simulated election here between George Washington and Benedict Arnold.
I think I know who I'll vote for.
All right.
Go ahead, pop it in.
I'm on your side.
For you.
Okay.
And just wait a
second.
So
when I go to vote at an electronic voting machine, it looks similar. It's just like this.
Just like this.
5% of the country.
Okay, so I say start.
Start, yes.
Yeah, I want George Washington.
Yes.
Okay, good.
Okay, now I do
next. All right. And cast ballot.
And I see that has registered my vote correctly.
Right.
George Washington, I'd like to cast my ballot. Very simple.
All right, I'm going to vote.
Just a minute.
All right, so every person gets a different voter access card, right? All right.
It takes a minute.
And loading base. All right, start. I'm voting for George Washington. Okay, cast ballot.
There you go.
Okay.
All right. Now I'm going to cast a third vote, also for George Washington.
All right. Well, we're going to watch just to make sure.
All right. Watch very carefully.
Voting ballot. You're starting. You're voting for George Washington. Okay, good enough. And then you cast your ballot.
So there should be three votes for George Washington.
Three votes for George Washington.
What are we going to see?
But because you have infected this machine with a virus, perhaps George Washington will not be the winner.
Perhaps right.
All right, so now you're putting in the supervisor card.
I'm putting the supervisor card. Now it's the end of election day.
Time to count the votes.
We're going to count the votes.
Yep.
All right, very good.
Right, so I stick this in.
Yeah.
And it takes a minute. I need to put in the highly secret pin, 1111.
Okay,
there you go.
I think you just accidentally said that out loud. Okay.
Okay, ballot station.
Not secret anymore. I'm going to end the election.
Okay.
And that's okay with me.
Yeah.
Okay.
And now I'm going to print the results on this printer.
Okay, quickly, very quickly.
Yes. And the results will come out. So here's what happened.
Yeah.
Inside the machine, it was keeping an electronic record of every vote.
Right.
Three votes for George. But the computer virus went and switched the votes inside the computer's memory.
All right.
And when you see this result, what you see, look at the tape right here.
Hold it right there very carefully.
One vote for George Washington and two for Benedict.
So you're saying that hackers would have had to have done this before people voted. They would have had to have infected it with a virus and then it skews the results.
Before election day?
Oh, my goodness.
Any time before election day.
Ed Felton, professor of computer science at Princeton, we thank you very much.
Revolution. 4409.